Well, hey gang, it's Tony here from the Portsmouth Aeroship Building Company with another episode of Unpacking Diesel Punk. Now, let's get right into it. The first thing that I need to start off with is my personal definition of diesel punk. Diesel punk is a method of creativity that combines the historic style of the mid-1910s to about the mid-1950s with elements of sci-fi, fantasy, and even horror. So that's the starting point that I'm working from as far as the definition. Now, here is why I feel that the movie Godzilla Minus One is a diesel punk movie. First of all, gang, if you hadn't seen the movie, you gotta go see it. It's not one of those Godzilla versus King Kong kind of, you know, action-packed fighting movies that can, you know, lean towards the silly side a little bit. It's not that at all. It really is well-written. And I really wanted to see this film mostly because I kept hearing all of the good things about this movie. So I really wanted to see it. Really was waiting for it to come to streaming. And then when I finally was able to see it, the extra bonus that I had, being someone that loves diesel punk, was really just coming to grips right in the middle of watching the film. I mean, it seemed like it would have been obvious, but right in the middle of watching the film, I started realizing that, oh my gosh, I'm loving this movie, especially because this is truly a diesel punk film. Now, here's what I mean by that. First of all, it's the era. It takes place immediately at the end of World War II. In fact, a lot of folks are saying that the original Godzilla movie actually took place about 10 years after, I mean, actually in real life, was filmed and took place about 10 years after the end of World War II. This is the first out of all the Godzilla movies where it takes place even before that. And so the setting of this is that it immediately takes place right at the end of World War II. So that's checking the box of at least it being in the era. But here's the thing that really at least adds to the storyline because of that time frame where it takes place. The main character, the protagonist in this film, actually starts out as, and we're introduced to him as, a kamikaze pilot that loses his nerve. In fact, the very beginning of this, and some of you history buffs know that towards the end of World War II, the Japanese military, one of the things that they were doing just as a last resort, just to not to lose the war, not to go out swinging, is the kamikaze pilots. Their main thing was, you know, just dive bomb into those ships and keep them from approaching the Empire of Japan. And so our main character is one of those kamikaze pilots from World War II that actually happens to lose his nerve. And so although this is a monster movie, the storyline is written about him dealing with that guilt of going back to his village, finding out his, and I'm not going to give you any spoilers here, but going back to his village, finding out that his parents are gone, and many folks in that village and where they're from have died from, you know, results of, you know, of bombing from the war, and him living with that guilt of having been a kamikaze pilot that did not follow through, and how does he live with that? And so that's actually this was really what made this movie not the traditional Godzilla kaiju monster movie, because those are mostly driven by the monsters and less about the human characters. This was a flipping of that. This was actually character driven. And the background, the backdrop of the movie was Godzilla. And Godzilla's appearance in all of this and everything that he did in this movie was phenomenal. It was phenomenal. So again, the style of the movie, of course, obviously when it took place, the style, the scenery, the atmosphere of it was truly World War II. I mean, I would say post-World War II, but it was so like immediately, like, you know, days, weeks, and just a year or two after World War II. But you felt it, you saw it, and so Diesel Punk was written all over it with the style. And then, of course, the twist, with it not just being a historically based movie, but obviously the twist of it was this monster. And here's what's interesting about the monster itself. And again, this is actually back to the origins of Godzilla when he began. Godzilla actually began as a metaphor of, you know, the atomic bombing. And so that was very much felt in this film, that, you know, Godzilla was not the, you know, the friendly character or, you know, the character itself. I mean, he was almost like a storm. It was almost like a tornado or a storm that comes through. Even when us, you know, when we deal with those storms and everything, there's no personality to it. It is just this looming threat that's coming through that we all have to survive. That's what Godzilla was within this. And it was all attached to the historical events of the aftermath of World War II and the perspective of these people that were that lived through it and were living after the fact and just kind of dealing with it. And, you know, we really saw that in this film. So, again, Diesel Punk written all on it, all through the whole thing. Now, here's another bonus for us Diesel Punk fans that was added in this movie that I did not expect. And it was when I saw it and when it was unfolding, I was like, yes, this is truly a Diesel Punk movie. Towards the latter part of the film, and again, no spoilers with this, but a featured part of this film that reconnected the protagonist in the film was the unveiling and showing us of this Japanese plane. It is called the Kyushu J-7W Shinden. This is for you fans out there that know this kind of stuff. Also called the Magnificent Lightning. But it was a true, real-world World War II test plane that actually had the propeller at the back. And it was included in the film. And it was amazing. So again, I love when Diesel Punk movies when not only do they have the history as the backdrop, but when they are able to include real things, whether it's real people or in this case, a real plane that was, a test plane. It had the propeller at the back, but you know, that kind of stuff is right down our alley. Talking to you guys, you Diesel Punk fans. So if you have not checked the film out, check it out. Make sure that you see it because it's chock full of adventure. Whether you're a Godzilla fan, you will love it. Whether you're someone that loves the action, you'll love that. But especially us Diesel Punk enthusiasts, we really will appreciate all of that because it is written with our kind of thing all on it. And I didn't even expect it. I just kept hearing that this is a great Godzilla movie. And I wasn't even sure of the time frame that it had taken place in. But just seeing all that unfold was a phenomenal bonus. So make sure that you check it out. Now, to add to this, I did, as you saw in the title, not only was I going to share with you why that Godzilla Minus Zero is a Diesel Punk movie, but I also wanted to just use this as an opportunity to include a movie that's also out about the same time, at least in the theaters, Furiosa, part of the Mad Max franchise, why it is not a Diesel Punk movie. And this is, those of you that have been hanging out with me for a while, you know, we hear this from time to time where a lot of folks do get the post-apocalyptic type movies kind of mixed up and they think that it is Diesel Punk. And it's mostly because they say that, well, all those vehicles, they run on diesel, right? That's not the case. The thing that I want to share with you is don't get caught up in the term diesel. Don't get caught up in the fuel type. Yes, you can use diesel in those, but just because something is incorporated in a storyline that may include diesel does not make it diesel punk. Obviously, guys, or, you know, it may not be obvious to you, but it's just a term just to kind of give us, especially those that may be creating for that genre, that term kind of helps us narrow down to, well, when does this take place? Steampunk, steam, okay, when does this take place? In the era that's closer to the Victorian era, where steam was dominant. I'm not saying that everything was running on steam. Yes, it can be included. But again, let me speak specifically to the diesel punk era. That yes, diesel was a big deal, but the term diesel punk just helps us kind of identify that era and everything else that can take place as far as the stories that we create. Post-apocalyptic is something totally different, especially because of when it takes place. Yes, they may be using vehicles that run on diesel, but that's not what makes it diesel punk. Again, my definition is diesel punk is a method of creativity that combines the historic style of the mid-1910s through about the mid-1950s with elements of sci-fi, fantasy, and even horror. So I hope you guys enjoyed this episode. If this is the first time that you've been here, please continue to follow us. Look at the other episodes in this season as well as season one. And this is the fifth episode of this season. So we've got three more to go. And just want you to stick with me. And please share this with someone else as well. And if you haven't had a chance to check them out yet, I would be honored if you pick up one of my books. My art books, either Relic or the Classified Report, Jetpacks, Commandos, and the Service Members That Inspired Them. So I'm going to include some links here so you can check those out. And we love for these to be great coffee table books that you can have in your home. That's it for this episode, gang. And I look forward to seeing you soon.
Oh, who's going to fix the whistle? So my poor old pup will know it's time for him to stop.